Hello everyone, welcome on this SciSports webinar. Today I will present work on predicting penalties, penalty directions. And my name is Lotte Brandsen and I work as a data scientist at SciSports. And I also do a PhD at KU Leuven under the supervision of Jesse Davis. And this is joint work with him that I will present today to you all. If you have any questions, you can leave them in the chat. And at the end of the session, I will take some time to answer some questions. So let's get started. I'll share my slides. So as I already explained, I will present work with Jesse Davis on predicting football penalty directions using in-match performance indicators. Why do we want to do this? Well, as you might all know, penalties are like an important aspect of the football game, and they can be game-changing. They can even let you win a championship. And to get a feeling of why we need to do this, I've got two examples of penalties that we will take throughout this presentation and give some examples for. So let's take this penalty by Miedema. That was a penalty that she took in the Olympics match against the USA. And she missed the penalty. It was stopped by the goalkeeper, and which led to the Dutch team to leave the tournament. And this one is a penalty by Jennifer Hermoso from Spain. And she scored a goal in the match against South Africa, which led to to them to proceed to the next round. So in the end, you see that these two examples really show you that penalties can be very important in football. And as a goalkeeper, you can be very valuable to your team if you stop this penalty. So this is why, in these recent years, goalkeepers and like goalkeeper coaches and assistant coaches, they started to collect information on this. And this is an example of a water bottle of Pickford, the English goalkeeper. And he had on his water bottle, he had the penalties taken by the players that he was facing in his match. This was typically done in a lot of goalkeepers throughout the world. They know before the game starts, they know the penalty directions of their opposing players. When I was working on this paper, I was like, okay, it's cool. It gives you some information, but does it give you like the right information? Because this is typically based on very small sample sizes. So if we look at Miedema's and Hermoso's penalty, and we look at the penalties they took before this penalty, then if we would base our decision for the goalkeeper based on these penalties, then for Miedema we would say, okay, you should stay in the center because, well, she took one penalty before in our database, and this was in the center. For Hermoso, we would wrongly advise to go to dive to the right corner from the goalkeeper's perspective. Because based on 12 penalties, also a small sample size, she shot in the left corner more often than in the right corner. But in this case, she shot to the other side. So what if we would not take penalties just from this player, but we take all data that we have from all penalties taken all over the world to find patterns in these data, in these penalties? So we can say, okay, for instance, Hermoso, she took 12 penalties, but maybe we could also learn from other penalties from other players to see what she is doing. So when we do this, we use our model, we see that we can find these patterns in these penalties and we can better estimate the probability. So for these two examples, our model predicted for Miedema's penalty, predicted 59% that she would shoot it to the left corner. And for Hermoso, it predicted 52% for her to shoot to the right corner. So we can use this data, these examples from before, to get better estimates for penalties. And I will explain in this presentation how we do this. What do these two penalties have in common that I just showed? There's some interesting insights from these two penalties. Both of these players, they already scored a goal in this match. Miedema already scored twice in this match. They were both giving excellent passes, so they were really involved. They're both center strikers, but they both were really involved in the play of their team as well. They had some high impact dribbles in this match. And what did they both do? They both aimed their penalty to their natural corner. So the natural corner is for a right-footed player, it's the left corner. facing from the player's perspective, and for a left-footed player, it's the right corner. And they both aimed for their natural corner. So this brings me to my research question, which was, does in-match player performance influence player penalty directions? So does it impact you if you play great, which corner you choose? Or when you're not playing well, when you're playing poorly, maybe you feel less confident, maybe you make different decisions. And that is the thing that we wanted to address in this paper, in this research. So an outline of this presentation, I will first explain how we predict these penalty directions. Then I will explain how we can measure in-match play performance. We will look into the penalty direction predictor, and then in the end, I will show a use case how we can use this penalty direction prediction in real time during a match to provide the goalkeeper with an advice where to dive to. So what we did is we collected data from a lot of penalties from that we've seen before, and we collected information about their contextual features, the goalkeeper performance and the taker performance. So we wanted to capture like one more contextual information, like, okay, what is the score in the match? What is the gender of the player taking the penalty? We also wanted to take into account what the goalkeeper was doing. So maybe the goalkeeper was already playing a really good match. Does that impact the decision of the player taking the penalty? And of course, our main research question is, does the taker performance, does it influence what the decision is that the player makes when taking the penalty? And to give a bit more examples of what we collected, these are all the features that we call the contextual features. So we annotate whether it's whether it's a female or a male taking the penalty, because we have data from both women's and men's football in our data set. Lots of time played so far in this match. What's the score difference? So are you leading or are you losing? Were you fouled prior to the penalty? So if a player is fouled, that leads to the penalty. Do we also take that into account? What is the preferred foot of the player? Was it a shootout penalty or not? And also, is this a regular taker or not? And a regular taker is someone is a player that took at least 5 penalties in our data set. So we also saw some differences in the way regular takers take their penalties and irregular players take their penalties. And quite often in shootouts, there are a lot of irregular takers that take penalties. So this is all the contextual information that we captured. Then we also added, like I already said, two features for the goalkeeper, which are really simple. So we look at the number of saves that this goalkeeper already had in this match. And we also annotate whether this goalkeeper stopped the penalty in the match. And then the information on the taker. So we also wanted to capture, like, okay, is this taker feeling more confident? That's what we try to measure, taking into account the performance of this player so far. So what we did is we collected information, like, okay, this is how many shots did this player miss already in this match? Did this player already miss a penalty? What is the passing accuracy so far in this match of this player? And also, what are the number of goals and assists that the player already has? But there's something missing if we look at goals and assists when measuring player performance. Because it's not just about scoring. Football is, of course, about scoring goals, but it's not always the players that score the goals that are playing the best. As these two players, Xavi and Iniesta, they didn't score that often. They all had some assists, of course, but they were also very valuable in passes leading to goals in the end. So that's why we take something more into account. And to explain this, I've again a video. So this is a video of two passes, where one of them is an assist and the other one is not. And we start with the one that's not an assist. So here you see Dominic Janssen, Dutch player, passing the ball to her teammate. It's a pretty good ball, I would say. But in the end, they didn't manage to score, but they also didn't even manage to have a shot on target or even a shot. So this will typically not be annotated as an assist or a key pass or a pre-assist, pre-key pass. And this one, it was a bit quick maybe, but there was like a very small short pass from the Busquets to Messi. And then Messi dribbled and scored. So, well, you might agree with me that it's a bit unfair to say, okay, this pass by Busquets was better than the pass by Janssen. But when you just look at key passes and assists, you won't see this. Because Busquets would have an assist and a key pass, and Janssen would not have that. So that's why we, this is older work, but that's why we introduced a few years ago the FAVE framework. It's also something that we currently also use it in the recruitment platform of SciSports, the contribution ratings, we call them. And this is what values every action. So every action gets a value by the FAVE framework. And what it actually does, it measures the impact that this action has. So we look at the value of the game state before the action and after the action. So the pre-action game state and the post-action game state. And if we measure the differences between these two game states, we can measure, okay, how well, how much did this action, was this action expected to add to this play? So, but how do we measure this game state value? What we do there is we look at, on the one hand, we look at the likeliness of scoring a goal in the near future from this game state. So given Janssen has the ball in this position, what is the chance that you will score a goal in the next 10 actions? And on the other hand, we look at the likeliness of conceding a goal. So what is the likeness that there will be a goal scored by the opponent team in the near future? And for this example, this likeness will be pretty low because she's having the ball over there, but you might, we also want to value actions like tackles and such, and then you can also change the likeness of conceding a goal. So we also want to measure defensive actions, value them. So if we do this for both these game states, so before and after this pass by Janssen, we see that before her pass was given, the likeness of scoring a goal was pretty low, 0.006. And after her pass, this increased to more than 5%, 0.051. And also the chance of conceding a goal changes a bit, but that's not very impactful. And then we can measure calculate the FAPE value by taking the differences between the likeness of scoring a goal and the conceding a goal, where having like a lower likeness of conceding a goal is of course positively rewarded. So this pass gets a FAPE value of 0.046. And I don't have the numbers by heart here, but I know that the pass by Busquets was valued way, way lower. So that is why this FAPE framework can really help us to measure performance of a player. And then what we do in this, what we did in this research is we used gender-specific models. So we have data from women, from the women's game and the men's game. And the games are of course pretty similar, but we also see that there's like some differences in how it's played and how goals are scored. So that's why we used two different models. So one that we really trained on data from the women's game, and one that we trained on the data from the men's game. And then you see, for example, in this this one from this pass by Janssen, and so the video that you saw, that Janssen's pass is rated pretty similar by both models. So the women's model values at 0.045, and the men's model 0.0434. But the difference is in the cross by Pop. So the next cross, which was rated higher for the men's game. So which maybe in the men's game, this would lead more often to a goal than in the women's game. And we see some other differences as well for these models. So that's what we use for this research. So then we can calculate the FAPE rating per 90 minutes. So we always normalize this per 90 minutes of play, and we compute all the FAPE ratings for all the actions that the player does, and then we can sum them and then compute the total contribution so far in this match by this player. So we do this for every penalty that we have. We compute the FAPE rating so far. But another issue that we have there is that players have different standards. So for the two players that I showed in the beginning, Miedema and Hermoso, for the ones not knowing them, they're really good players. So they belong to the best players in the world, and also like the best strikers in the world. So this is a a plot of the vape ratings for all center forwards in the top competitions in Europe, with at least 900 minutes of playing time. And then we see that Hermoso and Miedema are amongst the top performers. So it's unfair to compare their vape ratings with other vape ratings. So for Hermoso, if she's playing okay, her vape ratings are different than for a player like in the red dot in the left corner. So that's why we need to also take into account the standards of the players. And we not only do this for the vape ratings, but also for the other performance indicators. So we compute the Z values, which typically tell us like the higher the Z value, the better. And also when it's positive, it means that you're playing better than we expect from you. So we correct for these own standards of the players, and then we can see, is this player playing better than we expect from this player? So we collected all these features that I just explained for all penalties. And then we also add for every penalty, we tell the computer, the model, what was the corner that it was aimed towards. And we have three different corners, the non-natural corner, the natural corner, and the center. And if we then use all this information from all these penalties that we have, we can train a machine learning model that can help us to predict, that will predict for us the values of the corners, the estimates of the corners. So we collected all this data for more than 6,000 penalties. We used these 6,000 penalties for training, and we had some different sets to test the model on. That's typically what you do in machine learning. So we have all these features with their labels, and then we put this into a penalty direction predictor. And this penalty direction predictor, finds patterns in these penalties. So it will learn from all these penalties, it will find patterns, and that will help the model to predict new penalties. So what we, for example, what the model learned is, for example, that players, so male players, they aim more often for the center than female players. In shootouts, the natural corner is more popular. Players that were fouled aim more often for the center, and players playing well aim way more often for the natural corner. And that's the interesting thing. So the players that play well, they aim more often for the natural corner. And that's what we wanted to investigate, whether, you know, the performance of a player in a match is really is changing the way they shoot their penalties. And well, it does. And this penalty direction predictor, of course, finds more patterns, also more like combinations of things. And then when we have like a new penalty, so we have the model is trained, and then we have a new penalty, for example, Miedema's penalty, we can compute all the features. So we can compute, okay, what was her vape rating in this match? Was it better or worse than we expect from her? And all other stuff. But we don't know the corner that she will aim for. So we put this into the penalty direction predictor, and this will then output probabilities for each of the corners. So in this case, like I already showed at the beginning of the presentation, it was 59% for her natural corner. So that's the left corner. And that's also the one that she shot the penalty towards. So that's, I think, an interesting thing. But what is also interesting is that in general, maybe people already know this, but in general, players tend to aim more often to the natural corner. So for right-footed players, it's more often to the left, and for left-footed players, it's more often to the right. So these are like the base probabilities, as we call them. So in general, 48% of the penalties go to the natural corner of a player. But if we then compare our probabilities to these base probabilities, we still see that our model added an additional 11% for Miedema's penalty to her natural corner. And if you use these probabilities in a smart way, you can gain an edge over just doing what's more often done, the natural corner. Or if you use like Pickford, you use like the previous penalties. That works worse than our approach. So that also brings me to the model evaluation. So, general, what I just said, we do way better than using the player's previous penalties because, the sample size are pretty low for these previous penalties. Well, we also slightly outperformed the baseball blitz for non and natural corners, especially near the end of the match. So we're better, our model performs better near the end of the match, and also pretty well in, or the best actually, in shootout penalties. This also because in shootouts, more often, what I already mentioned, irregular takers take penalties, so there's more an edge to gain there. But there's still room for improvement, especially for penalties at the start of the match. And well, our feeling there is that performance indicators are less reliable and stable at the start of the match because we don't really know yet how well this player is playing. So they can be, well, they can go both ways. So there's really room for improvement there to make it more stable at the start of the match, or to, well, not use the model at the start, just use it at the end of the match. That could also be a solution. Yeah, and that brings me to the use case. So it's, of course, you know, interesting to see, but you also want to know how can we use this in practice, because that's in the end what would be the goal. So if you take the example of Miedema's penalty in the match against the USA, so this was like a quarterfinal match against the USA at the Olympics this year. And if we then look at this match, we can compute over time what the corners are what the probabilities are for each of the corners, and then we compare again with the base probabilities. So you see at the start of the match, the probabilities are pretty pretty stable, pretty the same for all corners. But then, in the, what is it, the 17th minute, she scores a goal. Actually, out of nowhere, she scores a goal in the after a good take-on in the box. And you see, when we compute the values, we see that it increases for a natural corner. So would she be given the opportunity to take a penalty after this goal? We would really advise to dive to the natural corner in this case for the goalkeeper. And then she continues to play well, so we also see that the chances of her shooting to the natural corner remain high. She's giving a lot of excellent passes in this part of the match. Then at the beginning of the second half, she's like a bit invisible, so she only touches the ball twice. And we also see that the chances for her playing to the natural corner, for shooting to the natural corner, they decrease. But then, of course, it's Miedema. She scores again, and then we see that it increases again to a higher level. And then she continues to play well. Unfortunately, the Dutch didn't score in the rest of the match. But the chance of her shooting to the natural corner remain high, and even they increase even more. And then we are at the end of the match, and the chances are really high that she would shoot to the natural corner, what she did in the end. So let me check. Yeah. So then I have this. Well, I could show it shortly, because I like to show it. So that could work like this in real time. So you would, that's how I imagine it. You sit on the bench with a tablet and you see this probabilities changing. And then once a penalty has been given, you can advise the goalkeeper what to do. So this is how it changes over time. In the end, she shoots to the natural corner. So if you go back to the slides. To conclude. Players make different penalty decisions depending on their in-match performance. So that was actually the research question. And we see that, players that play well aim more often for the natural corner. Our predictions work particularly well for penalties near the end of the match and shootout penalties. But they can be improved at the start of the match. And given live data, we can provide these probabilities in real time to help the goalkeeper with his or her decisions. And that's what we showed with the example from Miedema. That was the presentation. Thanks for listening, and I have some time for questions. Let me see if I can see them. Yeah. There's a question, will you provide a recorded session on this webinar? I think we do, right? I think everyone, yeah. So everyone who attended gets the recorded session sent to the by email. Next question by Tim. Did you consider using? I'm not sure if you see this, but did you consider using a Bayesian approach to combine the takers' tendencies, even if it is on very limited sample size, with the predictive power of in-match performance? Yeah, that's a really good question, Tim. Yeah, we did consider this. I think it would be interesting for future research. So it would be for the people not very known with Bayesian probabilities, but you could, at the start of the match, you could, for instance, combine information from different sources, and if you know have enough confidence or like enough confidence that one of the things is like has enough examples, then you can use that. So it could be very interesting to do this for limited sample size, so you can combine our model with also with historical penalties from this player, and then you can get to even better predictions. So that's thank you for that question. Yeah, question from Hadi. I think you see that in the screen now. Can you also talk about the performance of the model AC ROC or F1? Also calibration curve. Again, good question. I decided to leave it out of the presentation because I also wanted to focus mostly on the use cases given the audience. But yeah, I can talk about this. So we have we looked at the AOC ROC of the models and also the log loss values, because we have like three probabilities over the left corner, over natural corner, non-natural corner, and the center. The AOC ROC, or like the log loss, I mean, is 0.94 opposed to 0.97 for the model using the base probabilities, and using previous penalties, it's even worse. That one is above one. So we're really outperforming the one using historical values, historical penalties, and we're slightly outperforming the other one. But as I already mentioned, we can have some improvements there, especially for the penalties at the start of the match. So thanks for that question. Yeah, so the other question, okay, that's... So there was another question by Rosa, Maria. Which machine learning model architecture did we use? So we used two different types. So XG Boost model, but also an explainable boosting classifier. I can really recommend everyone who's into machine learning to have a look at this. So it's from the Interpret ML package. And it gives you the opportunity to really get into your model and to get some explanations from your model. And also maybe good to mention is that after this video, you will all be leaded to a blog post regarding this presentation, and it will tell you this blog post mentions which models are used and gives some more explanations and some links to the package as well, so you can see that more over there. Question from Jacopo. Nice to that you're watching. Yeah, so you mentioned that it's not balanced. We didn't do this, but I think it would be a very interesting thing to consider in future research to look at this imbalance. Because of course the center is it's way less often shoot to the center, so that's why it's imbalanced. And I think it would be interesting to take a look into this. Yeah, I totally agree. Another question from Hadi. Is the model able to help handle situations a player or a goalkeeper just comes to the pitch? Yeah, it can handle this. So then the in-match performance is all the Z scores are zero for this player, so we don't know anything. Or they're zero. So but it won't be. So it will take mostly into account whether it's like what the more like the contextual features actually of this disability then. Yeah, but it's able to handle it, but it performs worse. Vina has a question about shootout and non-shootout. I look into this, and in shootouts, it's tricky to take it by heart, but I think in shootout penalties, it's more often, that's what you mean, right? Yeah, so in shootout, it's more often to the natural corner. And also in shootout penalties, you have more often, you have players that are like, that don't take penalties that often. And I think in general, these players shoot more often to the natural corner. But I don't know this by heart, so I can look this up for you. This is also an interesting question by Juan. So what if the attacking team also uses this technology? I think that's very interesting thing. So I think more and more teams will use, I think, models to predict corners. And so not necessarily this model, but data to predict corners. And I think it's also very interesting to use a model to predict where the goalkeeper would dive towards. So it will also be an interesting approach. But then in the end, you will have two teams fighting based on their data. But I think then you need to have the best data scientists to have the best predictions. But it would be interesting to see what happens then. And then at some point, it's going to be like a game theoretic thing to look into. So that's about the attacking team. There's quite a lot of questions, so I don't have time for all questions actually, because we're already over time. I can take one more question. So this is about the male and the female data. So what was the main reason you differentiated the male and female data? And what was the accuracy difference? So that's another research that I'm working on. So that's actually why. So what we see is that in the women's game, goals are scored differently. So for instance, headers take place closer to the goal. They're more likely to yield a goal. And also the way that the crosses are different in the women's game. So that's actually why we see that if we train a model only in women's data and only in men's data, that we see different results. So I don't know these accuracies by heart, but what we actually did is we trained a model on women's data, one on men's data, and then we applied both models on their own gender, but also on the other gender, to see the differences. And then we saw that the female model performs best on the female test set, and the men's model performs best on the men's test set. And that's actually like, telling us that it's maybe better to it's better to have different models to use here. I think we're over time, so I'm not I'm sorry I cannot answer all the questions, but I'm really happy that you all have so many questions, and you can also reach me by email. It's on the screen. You can use this email address or also the SciSports email address to contact me, and I can always answer your questions. And like Jelle also mentioned in the chat, we have like a publication about this research on our analytics blog. So take a look at that, and thanks for your attention. And hopefully we will see you in the next SciSports webinar.